by Professor Calabrese. So, as I said, if you have to print the poster, send it by today and at latest Monday morning to the printing. All right? Thank you very much.
Okay, so last time I promised that I would have answered questions if you had some by restudying the notes. Do you have any question on what we discussed during last lecture? Not even a single small one, no. Yes. That's the goal of the last lecture. In one specific case, then any case is different. I remember there was one question here from the first row. I don't remember who, which I said at the end of the lecture I will answer. I didn't answer. And ah, yes, okay, no, no, but I, this is a good one, but something more basic even. Okay, if the person that made the question is not here, I will, no. Definitely I will not remember. Okay, so Federica asked, what about, because I said at the beginning of the lecture last time that everything I will do will be, is valid in all dimensions. Okay, this was partially true because the concept of twist field is not valid in arbitrary dimension, okay? Only all the rest, the construction of the replica, the Riemann surface, etc., is valid in arbitrary dimension. The twist field, it's very specific on one dimension, because if you think about it, when you have a one-dimensional system, and you have a subsystem, the boundary between the two systems, which is called entanglement surface, it's one dimensional, it's zero dimensional. So it's a point, okay? It's always points. And so the action of this twist field, of this twist object is local and you can call them field. But if you are in higher dimension, like in 2D, okay? You have your system, you have a subsystem in 2D, you see, the entanglement surface, which means the boundary between one, okay? The boundary between A and B is now a one-dimensional object. And the equivalent of the twist field, okay, will be not a field, but a string, okay? So in 1D, you have a twist string. Okay? In higher dimension, you have twist whatever you want. The difference is that while fields or local operators are well-behaved objects, and we know how to deal with them, this object that acts on higher dimensional manifold are just weird objects that we don't know what to do, okay? So this concept is very fruitful in one plus one dimension, but it's instead not really useful in higher dimension, even if there are, okay, there are many people that are trying, that are working in some, in the direction of taking something out of this idea, but for the moment there is really nothing. Okay, maybe some of you in the future will do something in this direction. It's still an open problem how to extract useful information by the concept of twist higher dimensional object, okay? Other questions? Okay, if there are no questions, I will go on with the lecture. The goal of this last lecture, I mean, for me, this hour and the hour after are the same lecture, is to provide you one example of the calculation to make happy your friend there, okay? where we can work out the calculation of the entanglement entropy up to the end. And the example that I will discuss is the calculation of the entanglement entropy in a conformal field theory, okay? But I'm very... But I'm pretty sure that within this room, not all of you are familiar with CFT, no? So who knows conformal field theory here? Wow. I would have expected even less, okay? So, anyhow, for all the other people that are not familiar, I prepared a very short introduction to conformal field theory, which half an hour, just to fix the basic concept. Everything will be very basic and not neither rigorous, neither precise, but it's mainly done to fix the names and concept that we can use. So for the people that know it, don't take it too deeply. For the people that don't know conformal field theory, this will be just an introduction, not even an introduction, just a collection of concepts that should be done much more precisely and rigorous if you want really to understand and use these things. But still, I guess that can be useful, okay? So, a conformal field theory is a quantum field theory, QFT, that is conformal invariant. Conformal invariant means that it's invariant under the conformal transformation. And the conformal transformation are those space-time transformation, which means like x go in x prime, which is a function of x. So it's a space-time transformation where the vector x is tau x1 xd, where d is the space dimension. And we work in Euclidean time just to have an easy metric, okay? So the conformal transformation, the conformal transformation of the space-time, which conserve the angles, that's the way. Okay, so you map your space-time in our space-time, but the angles should be locally the same, like I could form a square in something like that, okay? Where all these angles are locally 90 degrees, but the overall geometry is different, okay? This is a standard conformal transformation. I don't want to write down even what it is, okay? So what are usually the conformal transformation, okay? Obvious conformal transformation is this. So conformal transformation include translation, for sure. If you translate your system, you don't change the angle. Rotation. If you rotate the space-time, angle don't change. Scale transformation or dilatation. If you just change your scale of the system, angles don't change. And this is almost everything, actually. What is missing is just something called the special conformal transformation. Okay, which is something... I don't want even to write, it's a special transformation, but basically is a combination of rotation and dilatation, so nothing really special. Right? So these are the set of transformations that generically conserve the angle. Right? And so if your theory is invariant under this transformation, it's a conformal field theory in arbitrary dimension. Okay, this is in any D. By the way, every time that I will use small d for me means space dimension. Capital D is space-time dimension, so it's d plus one. Okay, just to have a standard symbol that we don't mess up. But something special happened in two dimension. Okay, in two space-time dimension. Okay. QD is spatial. Why it's spatial? Because all holomorphic function are conformal. What I mean is that if you write, if instead of using the coordinate tau and x, you move to z and z bar, which is equal to x plus it and x minus it. Okay, so just a change of space-time variable name, okay? Any function, any change of coordinate, z, the cos in w, equal f of z, where with f, a holomorphic function, any of this transformation is conformal. And this is trivial. You studied in complex analysis, okay? You studied in complex analysis that because of Riemann-Cauchy theorem, which means that the derivative with dx of the function is equal to derivative with respect to y, etc., the angles of transformation, the angles are conserved. Right? So this, if you don't remember, maybe you don't remember how to prove it, but you may remember the thing that the cross derivatives are equal. Okay? And this is exactly the only condition that is required to preserve the angles. But what are the consequences of this invariance? Is that the algebra formed by the holomorphic function, okay? The algebra formed by the holomorphic functions is infinite dimensional. You can write, you can expand your identity function in power series, okay? You can see each z to the n as a generator of your algebra, and you have infinite of them. These are independent objects, because you cannot write z cube in terms of z square. Correct, no? So if you want to define an analytic function, you have infinite parameter. All the coefficients of the series, okay? So you have you have infinite many of this transformation, not just a rotation. Usually it's a three-parameter family of in three dimensions, no? In two dimensions, it would be only one-parameter family. Okay? Instead, all analytic functions are an infinite dimensional family. Okay? But if there are, if the algebra is infinite dimensional, it means that there should be something really big behind it. And in fact, this is more or less equivalent to the fact that this theory are exactly solvable. Yes, they are integrable and even more, actually. Definitely are integrable. Okay. At least the ones that are unitary, if you go, if you consider a non-unitary conformal field theory, okay, even what does mean integrable is not clear. If it's not unitary, so let's not go in this. Could be, but let's not go in that direction. Unitary conformal field theory are obviously integrable because you have an infinite number of constraints, actually even more than what you need. So it's sometimes people refer to integrable conformal field theory as super integrable because they have they are really nice. Okay? Yes?
What do you mean by exactly?
That you can solve them. Okay? That if you, that you can solve everything about them.
Solve.
You can have, okay. I have a theory. Whatever theory you have, in, these are interacting theories also, okay, so they're not free theories. A theory is completely specified, for example, by all correlation functions. You know very well that if I have a generic phi to the fourth theory, not that I can write all correlation functions. You are lucky if you write perturbative expansion of the two-point function, and this is not even exact. What I'm telling you, that in this case, you can, in principle, reconstruct all the correlation functions of the theory. Okay? And in some cases, that's been done. Okay? It's just more complicated things you want, more work you have to do, but you know the way you. People know the way how to deal with this problem. So you can reconstruct all correlation functions and all. These things that I've just told you were known from many years, but is it of any use for real world? Is this set of conformal transformation relevant to something? Okay, that's the first question you should ask. And there is a very old result due to Polyakov, 73, which showed that under very mild assumption, there are some assumptions, but they are met by almost everything, if a system, if a theory, if a QFT is invariant under rotation, translation, and dilatation, then it is automatically conformal invariant. It's quite very strong argument. This in arbitrary dimension, in any D. But this is particularly important in 2D. So you only need to have something that is invariant under rotation, dilatation, and translation. Okay? And automatically you generate, okay, this is, it's not trivial to understand it, but just trust me, all these much bigger invariants. If you think in two dimension, translation are just two objects, rotation is just one and make three, dilatation is another operation, so it's four in total. So you need the invariants under only a four-dimensional algebra, and you generate, by dynamical symmetry, an infinite-dimensional algebra. It's something, okay. The expert knows it's not difficult. It will take 20 minutes to show how it works, but okay. Not that we have so much time, but probably all the people that write the end before know how to do it. And it's quite a remarkable result. In fact, in those days, this became suddenly something extremely important. But 73, you can realize, it's also the same time of renormalization group. And this happened exactly at the right time when scale invariance, dilatation, was understood to be the main characteristic of critical systems, systems that are in a gapless phase or undergoes a quantum phase transition. Okay, so dilatation, scale invariance. Is equivalent to critical system. Or if you want, which is the same as gapless points and phases. So if you have a critical point in one spatial dimension, or in two, or in three spatial dimensions, okay, or phases like Luttinger liquid, okay, this automatically is conformal invariance. With the caveat that you should keep in mind, the system should be also invariant under rotation and translation, okay? The fact that is invariant under rotation in space-time means that x and tau should go in the same way, okay? So if you remember, you must have this rotation invariance in Euclidean space-time, rotation invariance implies Z equal to 1, okay? Remember, I defined this like critical exponent last time, which means basically that E should go like V to the key. Which means it should be a relativistic field theory, okay? It should not be a Galilean field theory with different. Clearly, for quantum many-body system, the most important representative of this conformal field theory are Luttinger liquid, Luttinger and Fermi liquid in 1D, okay? So this includes CFT, includes Luttinger and Fermi liquid. That, by the way, for your information, are just the simplest CFT you can have, okay? The other one are more complicated. This is just the simplest example of CFT is the free boson, which means Luttinger and Fermi liquid. So, do you have questions? I mean, not the people that raised the hand before that know really about CFT, but the other one. Yes? Fermi liquid is a special case of a Luttinger liquid, first of all. Okay, so and anyhow, it's a free bosonic theory. You can just use bosonization if you ever heard about this concept. You can use bosonization to map the Fermi liquid into a Luttinger liquid, into a free boson theory with the Luttinger liquid parameter k equal to 1. It's a special case of a Luttinger liquid. Yeah, this is okay. This is 1 plus 1D. Was exactly that the point? Okay, this is. Yes? Yes, CFTs are, except the free boson and the free Majorana, it's equal 1/2. All the other cases are interacting conformal field theory. Okay, no, so in four dimension, okay, it's conformal field theory is not, are not exactly solvable in four dimension. But you may have heard, for example, in recent time, there was a huge activity on the Bootstrap program. Okay, people got huge money, huge prizes, etc., because they rediscovered the Bootstrap, which Bootstrap, if you ever heard this name, is just the practical implementation of conformal field theory in higher dimension. Since the algebra is not infinite dimensional, you should use this finite dimensional algebra to constrain your theory and take out information, as much information as you can. It's not infinite, so you cannot really solve exactly, but you can get very close to the solution. This is the Bootstrap program. If you ever heard about this Bootstrap, that's exactly what it's about. And people are using even in particle physics this, yes. It's a very fashionable thing. Actually, Polyakov made all these things for particle physics. Then there was a... The Bootstrap program started in the 70s, thanks to Polyakov and many other people, including people in Italy, okay? Then it got blocked for a long while. In 2D was solved by Bellamy, Polyakov, and Zamolgico, understood everything. Then was, in higher dimension, instead it stayed silent and sleeping up to like 5 years ago when Slavarichkov and others rediscovered the Bootstrap and understood that few more things can be done with the tools that we have at disposal nowadays, and they are using it now. No. This is really, it's a CFT, and one thing that changed surely from the 70s is the computational power that we have nowadays. They can use the same equation to put on the computer much easier and get something, but these are. The only fact that you can put on your computer and getting some initial solution allowed to discover a lot of relations that, okay, just by hands would have been very difficult. So I think the fact that there are computers allowed to have a big theoretical understanding also, not only. It's not a computational thing only. It's really a theoretical story that went on. Okay, this is definitely much more complicated than... Question? Yes? E is the conjugate variable of time. K is the conjugate variable of space. So if X and T should scale in the same way, their conjugate variable should scale in the same way. I cannot have X, if X goes like tau squared, this is not rotational invariance, no? And this will give a different rotational invariance. So I need that X should scale like tau, okay, which implies automatically that E should scale like K. Thank you for the question, because okay, this is the kind of question that... More? Yes? There is a difference in making the calculation, yes, in the end of the day, no. You can make both approaches, you get to slightly different things. If you then make weak rotation, you get to the other. It's much more intuitive to work in Euclidean space-time. But yes, it's, for many things, it's important to work in state and Lorentzian signature. That's, in fact, you can find in the literature both, and okay, they are both very important. Absolutely not. No, no. It's any massive field theory, usually it's invariant under rotation and translation, but it's not. You need scale invariants. That's the. Okay, if not, let's see something that scale invariants and conformal field theory provide us. Okay, first of all, let's start with the scale invariant. If you have a scale invariant theory, okay, you all study you all know basic concept of normalization group, and you know that each field phi j under a scale transformation, okay, of factor b will just go to b to the minus x j phi of r, where this x j is called the scaling dimension. Of the field. This is what scale invariant means, that okay, the various fields under a scale transformation are invariants, which means they get a factor out. They are not really invariant, they are covariant, they get a factor, and this factor define the scale transformation, the scaling dimension of the field. Okay, this probably you all know by conformal field theory, enough by normalization group. This object is connected to critical exponent, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I assume that this is, all of you are familiar with this. In particular, this equation implies that the two-point function of the field must be equal to b to minus x, 2xj, phi j r prime, okay? And you see that the only solution of this equation is that the two-point function must be an homogeneous function of r minus rj, which means that, okay, this implies that the two-point function of phi j r prime must be proportional to 1 over r minus r prime to the 2xj. Okay, you can obviously plug this form into here and see that this satisfies, but you can even easily convince yourself that this is the only one that satisfies this object, okay? Okay, I already used, you know that using translation and rotational invariant, the two-point function should be a function just of the of the absolute value of the distance. Okay, and this absolute value of the distance must be a power if it should satisfy this function. Okay, this is basic of normalization group. Probably you all know there is nothing new. Something new happens when we promote a scale transformation to a conformal transformation. Okay, like let's stay in 1 plus 1 d without making. Okay, and we wonder what happened. For under a general conformal transformation z that goes in w equal f of z, that as we said, f is an holomorphic function. First of all, you can see f of z locally which means just close to one point, is a combination. Of a translation, rotation, and dilatation. Okay? As you see, for example, from this picture, no? This point here went to this point here, and to go from here to here, you made a small translation. A rotation and a bit of dilatation, okay? If you remember what were the conformal transformation, you know that you can prove. And by the way, this fact is at the basis of the theorem of Polyakov. You use the fact that locally a conformal transformation is always that stuff, and then you reconstruct the global transformation, and you end up that is invariant under that. Okay, this is a parenthesis that is not important. But locally, this operation is that. So, you know very well that if I apply a rotation and a translation, not much change to the correlation function, because it just it's just change r minus r prime, so it's nothing. What changed something is the dilatation. It's a local dilatation. So one would expect, and the local scale factor is B of Z, it's local, is the derivative of F. Okay? The local scale factor is just the derivative of the function. Okay, the first thing that one should wonder is whether I can, that's where everything started in conformal field theory, if I can promote this global transformation to the local one. Which, if I can say that since this transformation is a combination of the three, may I tell that phi of W of Z is actually the local scale factor F prime of Z to the minus XJ, I'm taking the same convention, yes, times phi of Z. Is it true? Okay, so this is the first, this would be a first guess, no? You say locally is just that, so I imagine that locally only the dilatation, the scale invariant transformation matter, and there is not a global effect, okay? This is a first guess. Okay? What people have proved is that there are some operator, some fields, okay, for which this is true, for some field. This is true, and they are called primaries. And this is a very important category of fields, and one thing that we will show in the today, I don't know if now or later, is that primary fields are primaries, and then we will use all the nice properties of primaries, and the most important property of primaries is this one. It is the equivalent of this one, okay? Oh, sorry, of this one. So if this formula is true, it's trivial to say that phi of W of Z1, phi of W of Z2 must be equal to F prime of Z1, F prime of Z2 minus XJ times phi of Z1, phi of Z2. Okay? From, if this equation is valid, then automatically follow that the Tupin function should transform under conformal transformation in that way. This seems something very trivial and easy, but will be extremely useful. Okay? Just before, just to give you some idea and example of what you can do with this very simple object, imagine you have a two-point function on the plane, okay, of some operator on the plane Z. You can map the plane to the cylinder with a conformal transformation that is just the logarithm, okay? Think a bit about it. And so, from the result of the two-point function in the ground state, you get automatically the two-point function at finite temperature. If a theory is not conformal invariant, getting finite temperature, it's a mess. It's a lot of work. In a conformal invariant theory, it's just trivial. If you have the two-point function, that, by the way, is written there, the two-point function on the plane, okay, the two-point function of a primary operator at finite temperature is just, I can write you what happened under this. Any two-point function at finite T will be just 1 over beta is the inverse temperature, pi hyperbolic sine beta pi L over beta to minus 2xj. L is the distance. Okay, let's write x1 minus x2. This is equal time two-point function. You can get even different time correlation function without problem. Okay, so in a conformal field theory, finite temperature correlation are trivial because you can use this very simple relation. Okay. This is one example of the power of CFT. If you ever try to calculate a finite temperature correlation function, you know how difficult it is in a generic theory. Okay, so you can see the difference in action here. Having all these invariants and all this freedom in playing with transformation allows you to get really so many results that you cannot even imagine now. Yes? Sorry, yes, but this is an example, I can say. I don't have it written here, so I could have done even some. My memory could be wrong, but I don't think so. Beta divided by pi, hyperbolic sine, pi, x1 minus x2, divided by beta, to the power 2x minus, no, it's already down, so 2xj the power. But you can find this in any book, any notes, in everything about CFT. This is a very standard example. Hmm? There are infinite conserved quantity in conformal field. They are complicated, okay? The algebra of the conformal transformation is called Virasoro algebra. There are some generator of this algebra, okay, that are called Virasoro generator, okay, Virasoro operator, and some proper combination of the Virasoro operator are the charges. Like the Hamiltonian is, like, we are talking about things that will take really too much. The Hamiltonian will be L0 plus L0 bar that are two Virasoro. This is the easiest Virasoro operator associated with the holomorphic and anti-homomorphic part. And then, okay, you can construct many of them. You imagine you have all these generators that are infinite from L0 to L, L0, L1, L2, L3, L4. Each of them correspond to the power series of this guy. Okay, that's the idea. And in fact, L0 minus L0 bar is the momentum because you see that the constant in the among the holomorphic functions that are invariant The constant corresponds to a translation. If you add to a function something, you are just translating the function in space-time, and the generator of translation in space-time are called Hamiltonian and momentum. You can start saying it. Okay, Z corresponds to the rotation. Okay, and this is, and then you have all the other that are the strange transformation, the strange invariance, and to each invariance correspond a conserved quantity as usually, a conserved density. So this is the logic, let's say. Now, writing formula will really take too long. Yes? They don't form a basis in the sense of linear algebra, but the other fields are descendant in the sense that they can be obtained by application of this Virasoro operator that I just mentioned on them. So they are what you get by applying a Virasoro operator to one primary field is an independent field, linearly independent field, but it's okay. You can just get through this operation. So in this sense, so they are not a basis, but from them, through the application of Virasoro operator, you can generate all the algebra. And actually, since at some point, if you want to impose that your theory is unitary, you have to close this algebra and impose some relation that some are linearly dependent. Like if you get to order three when you start applying some of this Virasoro operator, you have some equation that constrain your theory and makes that actually the number of operators that you have in your theory is numerable and not really too many, as you want. Instead, a non-unitary theory, there are not this constraint and things get much more complicated, but okay. But okay, this is a very good point. They are called primaries exactly for this reason, because okay, from them you can generate the other, but not linearly in another way. Yes? Yeah, there are a set of, exactly like for scale invariance, also for scale invariance, there are local scaling operators that have this property, okay? In the same way, okay, first of all, the same operator that satisfies this for a scale invariant randomization group, so I'm giving for granted the randomization group and this kind of ideas, okay? So the same scaling, the scaling operator of your scale invariant theory are the one that can be eventually promoted to primary. And not all of them will be. In fact, now this morning lecture will finish with an example of a non-scaling operator, a scaling operator that is not primary. So this is not at all automatic. You expect wrong, but and I don't see what is, if this is much strong, first of all, this relation in a constructive field theory doesn't mean anything, okay? But if you accept this relation, the correlation function is just a trivial consequence of this relation. Eh? I take this object for two different points, apply Guinea, and I get this. So if you accept this, the relation of the operator, for the correlation function is, it's just a trivial consequence. I hope you see this. Okay? And actually, since in a constructive way of thinking field theory, this relation doesn't mean anything because you cannot really define the operator, okay, in any tracking theory, this relation in any book everywhere means that it should be seen as, when introduced in any correlation function, this relation holds. This is the definition. If you want to be mathematically rigorous, that I'm not, this relation is valid only when inserted in a correlation function, because outside of a correlation function, make very little sense of saying in a field theory because of all divergences, et cetera, what this means. Okay, so I don't see why you don't expect this, because it's really, if you say that you don't accept this, okay, we can start discussing, but if you accept this, the two-point function is just a trivial consequence of the operator. Actually, even I wrote the two because I'm interested in the two-point function, but the 20-point function is just, I put 20 of them and I have 20 derivatives. Give me your example, and I will tell you why it doesn't have anything to do with this. It's probably the best thing to do. And there's no problem at all. What is the problem? It's a scale invariant theory. Distance doesn't matter anything. You don't have to think to your microscopic model of spin that maybe they can get close. In a scale invariant theory, distance is doesn't exist. Distance 1 of distance 300, okay, this is what it means scale invariance. You scale infinite time and this does not hold. Then if you are thinking to apply this to a spin chain where there is a lattice spacing and by scaling, you arrive to lattice spacing, obviously this relation doesn't hold. At some point you will break down, but not because the field theory is not good, it's because the field theory doesn't describe your macroscopic model in that regime. Okay, you have to apply this formula to the macroscopic model where it's valid. Hey, don't, okay. If this is what you had in mind, then this is the answer. Okay, let's see if in the remaining 7 minutes I want to write down a specific example which will be important, which we will use in the afternoon of a non-primary field. Okay? Because one of the most important operator, okay, which is scale invariant, a scale invariant operator is the energy momentum tensor. Okay. Often in Comms Matter lecture is called stress tensor. I hope you just, okay, you know what we are talking about. In 2D, actually in 1+1 dimension, stress tensor T mu nu is a 2×2 matrix with the space and time coordinate. Okay. And in a CFT, only few components are non-zero, which are TTT and TXX, which sometimes are called T00, T11. Okay, I'm just writing to make you have seen this thing just to join with what you can already know without defining them. Okay? And, okay, TXT and TTX are 0 by scale invariance. You can easily convince yourself. Okay, don't let me go through this. And these objects are basically, okay, are function of x and t, are just the density of energy and momentum, okay? That's what they mean. That's why it's called energy momentum tensor, okay? They didn't give a name by some craziness. Okay, like the Hamiltonian of your system is just the integral in dx of t00 of x. Okay, that's what does it mean T00. And the momentum is the same with TX11. Okay, now I'm putting indices in random places, T00. Okay, and the momentum. That's what they mean. The theory is scale invariant, and so you can write a conserved quantity as integral of a density, which is the essence of Noether theorem. Okay? And these are the only two. There is not mixed term because we are scale invariant. So it's easier in this case. In two-dimensional conformal field theory, it's convenient to rewrite T00 and T11 in terms of this coordinate as usual, Z, that is X plus I tau and X minus I tau. And so the two independent component of T mu nu are T of Z, denoted as T of Z and T bar of Z bar, okay, which are, which just come from the, actually one is T00 plus T11, and the other one is T00 minus T11. And you can show, actually by making this combination, that this linear combination, the sum of the two, is just a function of, an holomorphic function of Z, okay, while the other one is an holomorphic function of Z bar that are called T and T bar. Okay, usually this object is a function of X and T, and a function of X and T is a function of Z and Z bar, not of the two separately. Okay, if you make the algebra, don't let me do this, you find in any book, okay, you find that the stress energy, and that's why all conformal field theory is nice, this T of Z is an holomorphic function of Z, and T bar of Z bar is an holomorphic function of Z bar. And they are called usually, in fact, holomorphic and anti-holomorphic component of the stress energy tensor. How T of Z transforms how does, let's use proper English, T of Z transform under conformal transformation question? The answer is not very easy and was discovered by Belavin, Polyakov, and Samolodchikov in the 84 in a seminal paper, and this equation is the equation that started conformal field theory, so it's really important. But okay, T of Z under a conformal transformation, as usual, Z that goes in W equal F of Z, transform in the following way. There is a term W prime of Z square times T of W, and this just tells you that the stress energy tensor is a scaling field with dimension 2. It scales, it's a scaling field. But there is an anomaly, and that's the important piece, C over 12 Schwarzian derivative of W with respect to Z, and the Schwarzian derivative is some object introduced by the famous mathematician many years before, which reads like that. Okay. I don't want to show where it comes from, but okay. It's a combination of the first, the second, and the third derivative of the function, as you see. Notice that if the function is linear, W second, if the function is linear, the Schwarzian derivative is zero, because W third is zero and W second is zero. So for a linear function, there is not this term here. And I already told you that translation, rotation, and dilatation are linear functions. OK? Okay? So for a scale transformation, this term is not there. So there is, T is a scaling field as it should be. But as soon as I promote to a global conformal transformation, there is an anomalous term, okay, that is important, and okay, which has this form that has been calculated again by better Samoljikov. It's difficult, but it's not. You don't have to worry how to derive this. The interested people can just take any book or lecture notes on CFT, and this is where things start. Okay? And, okay, it tells you that it's anomalous, and this quantity C is extremely important. This is called central charge. And the central charge is the most important quantity of a conformal field theory. It's what distinguishes, okay, almost one field conformal field theory from another, let's say. There is also something else, but this is the most important thing, like critical Ising model as conformal field theory, as central charge equal 1/2, Glattinger liquid as central charge equal 1, three-state Potts model as central charge equal 7 over 10, and so on and so forth. Okay? It's a very important quantity that when you know it, you know what you are talking about. Okay? And it enters there. This is the, if you want, this one of the possible definitions of the central charge, even if operatively not very interesting, but okay, it's a possible one. And basically, what we will do in next hour, we will use this relation to make your friend happy and calculate the entanglement entropy in a generic conformal field theory. Okay? This relation is enough. Okay? And then, if we have time, we will make some generalization by using this relation here. Okay? So the only thing of conformal field theory that you need to know are these two formulas, this one and that one. But I made this 1 hour lecture just to give you an idea of what we are talking about. I could have written these two formulas and go on, but that would have been too rough. Okay, so go to have lunch, me too, and see you in 2 hours.